What impact did the Gaels, the Romans, the Vikings, and various other peoples down through history have on the genetics of Scotland? And what haplogroups are common in the country today? Now, Scotland gets its name from the Scoti. This is a Latin term used by the Romans to refer to the Gaels, who began settling in Western Scotland from Ireland beginning around the 4th century AD. The Latin word Scotia, meaning land of the Gaels, was actually initially used to refer to Ireland. By around the 11th century, however, Scotia was being used to refer to Gaelic-speaking Scotland north of the River Forth. Now, Scotland is a country that initially emerged from the amalgamation of two peoples, the Picts to the northeast and the Western Gaels of Dalriada. These peoples unified into the embryonic Kingdom of Scotland, or Alapa, in 843 AD. In the following few centuries, Celtic-speaking Cumbrians of Strathclyde became part of Scotland, as well as the more Anglo-influenced southeast of the country, which was previously part of Northumbria. And then in the 13th century, the Norse-Gaels of the Western Isles became part of Scotland. This was followed by the Northern Isles of Orkney and Shetland in the 15th century, after large periods of Norse and Norwegian rule. Over several centuries, these gradual political and cultural consolidations gave rise to the modern borders of Scotland, which were largely in place by the late 15th century. But how did all this influence Scottish DNA? Now, today I've taken you to the beautiful island of Iona, which sits in the Inner Hebrides on the west coast of Scotland. This island isn't just beautiful though, it also has incredible history. In 563 AD, St. Columba, an Irish monk from Dalriada, sailed here with 12 companions. They built a monastery here, and this island became a hub of Christianity in the early medieval period. Iona Abbey, which still stands today, was built later in the 13th century, but it was likely built on, or near, the original settlement of these early monks. Iona was part of the Kingdom of Dalriada around this time, a Gaelic-speaking realm linking Western Scotland and Northeastern Ireland. The Vikings soon arrived, however. In 795 AD, this island was home to one of the earliest Norse attacks in all of Britain and Ireland, only a few years after the Vikings had raided Lindisfarne in England. This marked the beginning of a traumatic period for Iona. Further raids occurred over the next few decades with devastating consequences. In the raid of 806, for example, 68 monks were slaughtered at Martyrs Bay, an event that deeply shocked the Christian world. These repeated attacks eventually forced the Christian community here to relocate parts of their operations, and the island of Iona was later incorporated into the Norse-Gaelic Kingdom of the Isles. Yeah, what impact did the Vikings have on the genetics of Scotland, and is this still felt in modern Scottish people such as myself? And I have actually been called a Viking before off an Italian guy, perhaps because I'm 6'3". But more on the Vikings later. First, let's look at the early genetic history of Scotland. Now, look at this map. This is what the world looked like during the peak of the last ice age, known as the last glacial maximum, around 25 to 20,000 years ago. As you can see, Scotland, as well as many other northern countries, were under thick sheets of ice. As the ice melted, early hunter-gatherers started moving back into Scotland. Flint tools dated to around 14,000 years ago have been found in South Lanarkshire, used by some of the earliest peoples of the land we call Scotland today. Tools dating back to around 11,000 years ago have also just been found on the Isle of Skye this year as well. So around this time, Scotland was home to hunter-gatherers, but what about their genetics? Well, we know these early hunter-gatherers largely carried the mitochondrial haplogroup U5 and the Y-DNA haplogroup I2. Making them very old haplogroups in Europe, and their genetic legacy remains in Scots today at low frequencies. Now, around 4000 BC, Neolithic farmers from Anatolia arrived, introducing agriculture and new genetic lineages. These included mitochondrial haplogroups such as Gi, T, and K, and Y-DNA haplogroups such as G2A, E1B1B, and Gi. These early farmers mingled with or replaced the native foragers, especially in the lowlands. It was around this time of early farmers as well that we see sites like Scarabray pop up, a stone-built Neolithic settlement in Orkney. It was the next major wave of migration that reshaped Scottish DNA most profoundly though. Around 2400 to 2200 BC, the Bell Beaker culture arrived. They brought large amounts of Steppe ancestry and the Y-DNA haplogroup R1B-M269, particularly the subclad R1B-L21. Ancient DNA studies show a complete near-male line replacement around this time, from the Y-DNA marker I2 to R1B. A 2018 study published in Nature, for example, found that around 90% of Britain's gene pool was replaced within just a few centuries, a remarkable turnover. There was some regional variation though. A 2022 study, for instance, found that Orkney retained more pre-Beaker male lineages than mainland Scotland, in the form of I2 remaining more common compared to other parts of ancient Scotland, yet Orkney still felt the influence from Steppe ancestry in the Bell Beakers. So despite some regional variation, the Bell Beaker culture, the migration of Bell Beakers, laid the genetic foundation on which later Celtic-speaking peoples, like the Gaels, Picts and Britons, would emerge. I should also note that modern Scots, like all non-Africans, also carry about 2% Neanderthal DNA, a legacy from much earlier interbreeding events further south in Eurasia. So overall, the ancient genetic history of Scotland is very similar to other Western Europeans. It is a combination of hunter-gatherer, early European farmer and steppe ancestry, with a little Neanderthal DNA as well. But how did later historical events shape the genetic landscape of Scotland? Now quickly before we look at that, if you would like access to member-only videos, and I did just make one on Viking DNA differences recently, please consider becoming a member, either on Patreon or YouTube if you prefer everything on one platform. Check out the links in the top of the video description below, or click the join button on YouTube to get more information. Thank you, and now on with the video. Well, during the Iron Age and into the early medieval period, Celtic lineages and cultures spread across Scotland. Peoples during this time included the Picts, the Britons and the Gaels. These people shared broadly similar Bronze Age ancestry though. They did have cultural and linguistic differences, yet they were often within similar substrates. They all likely spoke Celtic lineages, for example, with Pictish widely believed to have been a pre-Celtic language, related to Brythonic tongues like Welsh and Cornish, although there is debate about the Pictish lineage in general. From a genetic perspective though, the Iron Age peoples of Scotland were largely continuous with the Bronze Age populations, though with some additional movements. The Gaels, Gaelic speakers from Ireland, began settling in Western Scotland around the 4th to 5th centuries AD, founding Dalriada. This Gaelic kingdom linked the north of Ireland with Western Scotland, especially around the Argyll region of Scotland, or coast of the Gaels. These Gaels intermarried with Picts and Britons, reinforcing existing gene pools rather than radically altering them. Now, there was a really interesting study done in Pelos Genetics in 2023. It looked at Pictish genomes and found that mainland Picts during the Pictish time showed broad affinities with modern populations of Western Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland and Northumbria, but less so with Orkney, Eastern Scotland or the rest of England. Now the reason for this west-east divide in Scotland is that Western Scotland is generally more Celtic, whereas Orkney and Shetland in the northeast has a large Norse influence, and the southeast has a little more Anglo-Saxon influence. We will discuss these points in more detail later in the video. Now this all suggests that while the Picts and the Gaels had some differences, both were genetically from the same genetic pool, the same Bronze Age substrate, sharing lineages like R1B, L21, and descended from a similar gene pool in general. Now an interesting difference between Scotland and Southern Britain is that between the Bronze Age and the Iron Age, Scotland experienced relatively little gene flow from continental Europe, unlike Southern Britain, which is interesting. A 2021 study published in Nature, for example, found that Southern Britain saw a large influx of people who were genetically similar to ancient populations from France during the Late Bronze Age around 1000 to 875 BC. This increased early European farmer ancestry in England and Wales, but not in Scotland, where no such continental influx occurred on a major scale. This study did actually add that this migration could have been a vector for the spread of early Celtic lineages into Southern Britain. Yet there are numerous theories as to the origin of Celtic lineages in general. Some argue that they could have arose in the Atlantic zone themselves, as opposed to coming from continental Europe, but this is a story for another time. From a genetic perspective, however, Scotland did not see this increase of French-like ancestry in early European farmer ancestry just before the Iron Age began, around 800 BC. This means that the spread of Celtic culture in Scotland appears to have been more cultural than migratory, and the migration of the Gaels largely reinforced existing genetic patterns with only subtle differences. There was no significant gene flow from continental Europe that changed the genetics of ancient Scotland around this time or just before this time, from the information we have at the moment at least, which is interesting and does seem to be different than southern Britain. Now, what about the Romans? What influence did the Romans have on the genetic history of Scotland? Well, the Romans never fully conquered Caledonia in general, but they launched several major military campaigns before the Gaels arrived. And it was actually the Romans who went on to call the Gaels the Scoti, of course. And I should note that in general, in some Irish and Scottish legends, the origin of the word Scoti is said to come from Scota, a daughter of an Egyptian pharaoh and ancestor of the Gaels. Now, a notable Roman period in Scotland was under a Greco-Law around 80 AD, which culminated in the Battle of Mons Gropius around 83 AD. This was said to have been a Roman victory, but many historians believe Tacitus exaggerated Roman success. The exact location of the battlefield is still unknown as well to this day. Now, we know the Romans went on to build the turf fortification Antonine's Wall around 142 AD, which ran through the central belt of modern Scotland. This was soon abandoned, however. In general, the Roman presence in Scotland was limited, especially in the north. From a genetic perspective as well, the Romans had little to no impact on Scottish DNA, and any impact would have been mainly in the lowlands. Some very rare Y-DNA haplogroups in Scotland, like Jai or E1B1B, might in a few cases trace back to Mediterranean connections, but these are extremely rare. Now, around the end of the Western Roman Empire, we saw the Anglo-Saxons arrive in the land we call England today. But did these Germanic peoples have a genetic impact on Scottish DNA? Well, they did end up having a small genetic impact on Scotland, largely through historical migrations and invasions centuries after the initial arrival. This genetic legacy is highest in southern and southeastern Scotland, especially around the Lothians and the Borders. Y-DNA haplogroups such as R1b, U106 and I1 are a little more common in the lowlands, given their proximity to England and controlled by the likes of Northumbria for a period, in the southeast anyway. But what about the Vikings then? Well, the Vikings raided this island numerous times in the Western Isles of Scotland in general, and they had a lasting impact on the genetics of Scotland. There was DNA differences between the Vikings though, and I did actually just make an exclusive member on the video on this topic. I'll put links in the top link in the video description below if you want to check that out on Patreon or on YouTube. Essentially, however, it was Vikings from the land we call Norway today that had the greatest impact on Iona and on Scotland in general, and they had the greatest impact actually in the Northern Isles of Orkney and Shetland, who of course were under Norwegian control until the 15th century as well. A 2019 study published in PNAS had some interesting findings. They found that the total Norwegian-like ancestry in Orkney and Shetland to be around 20-25%, much higher than any other part of Britain or Ireland. This study found that Norwegian ancestry is lower in the Hebrides, at around 7%, and averages 4% in the north of Scotland and in the southwest around Argyll. Other studies have found slightly different numbers of the Viking impact on different parts of Scotland, and this table shows the breakdown, the averages from a number of different studies. Irrespective of the precise numbers, Norwegian Vikings had a notable impact on Scottish DNA, with Norse settlers introducing and increasing Y-DNA haplogroups such as R1a, Z284 and I1. We also saw an interesting mix of genetics due to this Viking influence as well after their arrival. The Norse-Gaels are a fascinating case. These people had mixed ancestry, mixed Norse and Gaelic ancestry, and went on to rule the Kingdom of the Isles between around the 9th and 13th centuries. We also saw the rise of the Gallowglass warriors a little later. These were elite mercenary warriors of mixed Norse-Gaelic ancestry who largely originated in the Hebrides and Western Scotland. From the mid-13th to the 16th centuries, they served as heavily armed professional soldiers in Ireland, often fighting for Irish chieftains. Names like the McSweeneys, the McDonnells and the McCabes are linked to the Gallowglass. But did the Normans influence Scottish DNA? Well, their genetic contribution was limited overall, but many prominent Scottish families have Norman roots or connections, like the Bruce family. And this leads us nicely on to another major change in Scotland around this time, the rise of the Scottish clan system. Now, I have made a three-part series on the DNA of Scottish clans that I would recommend for those interested. And speaking of the Bruces, the Y-DNA SNP, RFTB15831, was very much associated with this family, and was very likely to have been carried by King Robert the Bruce himself. Now, later events also influenced the genetics of Scotland and the distribution of people with Scottish ancestry across the world. The 19th century Irish famine brought large-scale immigration to cities like Glasgow, for example. The Highland clearances and the resulting immigration reduced population diversity in rural areas, and is a major driver of why so many people across the world have Scottish ancestry. And recent immigrants from Europe, Asia and Africa have added diversity, particularly in urban centres. But what haplogroups and genetic markers are most common in Scottish people today? Well, if we start on the Y-DNA side, the most common male lineage in Scotland is R1b, especially the subclade R1b-L21. This subclade of R1b is associated with Atlantic Celts today, but it was brought into Britain and Ireland through the Beaker culture and associated peoples. Now look at this table. It shows the breakdown of the most common Y-DNA markers in Scotland today. After R1b, you can see that I1 and R1a are the second and third most common markers. These are both associated with the Vikings to a large extent, and are more common in the likes of Orkney and Shetland due to this Norse influence. Now these are some important snips in Scottish DNA that reflect the different ancestries down through history. Ancient Celtic snips are common, yet you can see the Viking influence in the Norse snip of R1a, Z284. You can also see the more Germanic snip of R1b, U106. But what about the maternal side? Well, this table shows the breakdown of the mitochondrial haplogroups, with H, especially H1 and H3, the most common in the country. This is followed by U5, K, J, and T2, a similar picture to other Western Europeans. Yet how has all this shaped the genetic landscape of Scotland today? Well, a really interesting study from PNAS was published in 2019. It analysed 2,554 individuals from across Britain and Ireland. They found that Scotland is split into six genetic clusters: the Northeast, the Southwest, the Borders, the Hebrides, Orkney and Shetland. And what is interesting is that these genetic divides roughly correspond to early Scottish kingdoms: the Picts to the Northeast, the Gaels of Dalriader to the West and Hebrides, the Britons of Strathclyde to the Southwest, the more Anglo-influenced Borders in Southeast, and the Norse-influenced Northern Isles. They go on to note that the majority of Scottish samples are placed in either the Northeast or the Southwest group, which is divided near the River Forth. This division echoes the historical distribution of Gaels versus Picts, the two founding peoples of Scotland. The authors also found that the Southwest cluster shares genetic affinity with many people in the north of Ireland, and the Borders cluster shares affinity with individuals of English ancestry, which makes sense. The Hebrides also shares affinity with many people in Ireland, which again makes sense given the history of the Gaels. Another finding was that the people of Orkney and Shetland are the most genetically distinct of populations across all of Britain and Ireland, in line with various other studies. This is due to two main factors: a Norwegian-like ancestral component, a large Norwegian-like component, as well as isolation. So overall, Norwegian ancestry is higher in the northeast than Orkney and Shetland, Germanic ancestry is higher in the southeast, and Celtic ancestry is higher to the west, although there is plenty of overlap as well. From a high-level perspective though, the genetic boundaries of modern Scotland are consistent with the kingdoms of the Gaels, the Picts, the Britons, and the Norse, mirroring historical patterns. Scotland also has high levels of certain traits, such as red hair, that I've covered in previous videos, like my video on hair colour and ancestry.
But what are the differences between Scottish and English DNA? Well, to find out, please click here. Thanks for watching, please subscribe and hit the bell, and let me know your thoughts in the comments below, and I'll see you next time.